I'm Andy Flick, and I work for RCA Records, which is a division of Sony Music Entertainment. I've been with Sony for almost 22 years now, and the last 17 of those years have been spent in the promotion department, currently for RCA Records and previously for our sister label, Columbia Records. And something that I found over those 17 years is that doing promotion really requires a softer skill set. Yes, promotion is used to create awareness and generate demand, but it's also used to build and maintain relationships. And a lot of times in marketing, we tend to talk about, you know, analytics and metrics, and rightfully so, but it's important not to forget the importance of good interpersonal communication in the process. Promotion requires great communication, creativity, and a lot of resourcefulness. And when it's done right, it can add a lot of power to your IMC efforts. So I want to start you off with a quote. I found this on the Grammy website, and I thought this was a great analogy for IMC. Music, even in its simplest form, involves multiple elements working together, each tone just as crucial as the others. Individually, it's a note. Collectively, it is power. I love that last part, collectively it is power. So throughout the presentation, I'm going to start with some of the nuts and bolts of promotion and communication, and then I'm going to get into some examples and some case studies. But you know, I didn't want to limit it just to RCA Records, so I kind of opened the floodgates a little bit to some other things in the industry just to kind of support some of the things I'm talking about. So first, I'm going to give you just a quick overview of the music industry, just to give you some context and the point of reference for the conditions that I'm working in. Then we'll get into a lot about communication and promotion, talk about some of the best content that's worked for me in promoting to radio stations. I want to just touch on social media, how it can be used not just for, you know, data dumps and sales pitches, but actually to help, you know, build and develop that reciprocal relationship with your followers. And then we'll talk about the importance of integrating the consumer voice into your efforts, how it can exponentially increase the reach of your promotional efforts. And then we'll wrap it up by talking about storytelling, how it can be used to connect the dots between your promotional efforts and also help to communicate brand meaning. So this is pretty scary. This was the music business from 1999 to 2009. Over that 10-year period, we lost 50% of our annual revenue. And the reason was the advent of digital. First, it was piracy. Then it was iTunes. And then eventually the introduction of the iPod, which was a game changer and really sort of, you know, reshaped consumer demand. So, you know, because the industry declined, the record labels, of course, had to get smaller as well. So RCA Records now is at about 45% of the number of employees that we were pre-2000. So like a lot of other industries out there, we now have to do more with fewer resources, which puts a lot of pressure on the promotion department. And our business model's changing yet again. As you guys are probably aware, we're moving from an ownership to an access model. We're pretty much already there. And what that means is that people don't want to own a physical product anymore. So people aren't buying CDs, and increasingly they don't want to store MP3s on their devices either. So everything is moving to streaming. 92% of millennials are accessing music through at least one streaming service. Problem for us is that it's not really sustainable yet. For example, Spotify has 60 million global users. Only 15 million of those are actually paid subscribers. The rest are using the ad-supported model, which still generates some revenue, but not the same amount as a paid one would. So it's we're going through growing pains. So what does a record label do? And we don't control distribution anymore, which we used to do. And anybody with a laptop can really record music, upload it to various sources. They don't need us for funding. You know, there's Kickstarter and other crowdsourcing platforms out there that people can use. So what is it that we do? What kind of value do we provide? And in short, we offer marketing and promotion at scale. We're a global company. We have relationships with radio, television, print. When we promote something to radio, it's not one radio station, it's every radio station in the country at that format. So we bring that scale to it. And we help to customize the marketing mix for each artist and each project. And through our promotional efforts, we create points of difference for those artists in the marketplace. And this is what I do, radio promotion. So my job is getting records played on the radio. So I work with about 100 radio stations across multiple formats, and my job is to persuade them to play our music through our promotional efforts. That's all earned media. You can't pay for airplay, it's illegal. So all of that has to be earned. So you saw the decline of a business as a result of digital. But what's impressive to me is that even with the rise of digital, radio is still the number one source of music discovery. So promotion really drives our company, and everything we do is seen through the lens of radio promotion. Radio also reaches 90% of every demographic, and more than that, it's very well segmented too, because you've got different radio formats. You've got country, you've got urban, top 40. So we can really target audiences based on radio formats, which makes it easier for us to do our jobs. This is what I look like most of the time, just trying to keep all the plates spinning. We've got a lot of projects at all times. Seems like we release a new record just about every week. And you know, we have a saying, precision promotion. We have to be very precise and well targeted in our promotional efforts, or these plates start falling. And these plates are pretty expensive. You know, these are artists' careers, and they put their careers in our hands to help them grow and to market them in the marketplace. And if you aren't good in your promotional efforts, then you're doing them a disservice. So just a quick reminder of promotion's place in the marketing mix. You've got the four basic P's of the marketing mix and the corresponding four C's of the consumer mix. I just really want to focus on this bottom line of promotion and communication. You can have the best marketing mix ever, but if you can't communicate it and if you don't promote it properly, no one's going to know about it. So if you drill a little deeper into the promotional mix, it's really made up of five main categories. We really, we function in all these categories, but I spend probably 95% of my time with personal selling and PR. Personal selling because I'm trying to persuade radio to play our music. I'm able to do that because of the relationships that I've built through PR efforts. Now, we do advertising, but that's more of a transaction. We don't do a ton of direct marketing, although we do it. And sales promotion, really, when you think about pricing, most every single in the iTunes store is going to be $1.29, sometimes 99 cents, sometimes 79 cents. We do offer some incentives here and there, but for the most part, I focus on personal selling and public relations. So the purpose of promotion, first and foremost, is to create awareness and generate demand. But it does so much more than that. Most people tend to just put it at the top of the consumer funnel, just thinking, okay, promotion, it's awareness. But promotion really exists at every stage of the funnel. You see at the bottom here, I have build advocates. And that's something that promotion is really responsible for. We're trying to build advocacy. So I've never been a big fan of this traditional funnel. To me, it always looks like the consumer drops out at the bottom of the funnel, and that's just kind of it. And I know we've talked a lot about that over the last couple days. So I prefer the hourglass funnel, which to me is just a better representation of the consumer path and the path that promotion takes. So you've got awareness at the top through to conversion in the middle, and then your advocacy efforts at the bottom, which create more awareness, more conversions, more advocates. Now, I'm a really visual person. We were talking about this the other day. I need a lot of visual cues to remember things. So when I think about this funnel, I look at it and I think, you know what? You turn that thing sideways, kind of looks like a bow tie, right? So I call it the bow tie funnel. And it's just an easy way for me to remember it. You've got your awareness efforts on the left, conversion in the middle, advocacy on the right, with promotion being the fabric that ties it all together. So it's just a good visual cue for me. So let's talk about your personal brand for a second, because your personal brand is linked to whatever brand you are promoting. So the image that you portray affects ultimately your brand image. So the way that you're communicating is so important to getting your message across the right way. So I don't know how many people have seen Simon Sinek's TED Talk about Start With Why. If you haven't, go see it. It changed the way that I do promotion and the way that I try to approach communication. And his whole concept was that most marketers, most companies, start with the what, which is their product, and they're trying to sell a product. And some will get to the how, which are your points of differentiation. You know, it's faster, tastes better, sounds better. But very few people ever get to the why, which is your purpose, your mission, your motivation. And his quote, which I loved, was that people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. And that stuck with me. It's so important to try to communicate from the inside out, because if you can get people to buy into you and buy into your personal brand, it makes it that much easier for you to promote your agenda. You know, whatever it is you're promoting, your idea, your proposal, whatever it is, if people buy into you, it just makes things that much easier. Here's a great example. I tried to think of a rock star, somebody that, you know, I could say, hey, here's somebody who embodies that. And then I thought, considering where we are, this is perfect. Think about it. He cares about the students, cares about the alumni, the faculty, the entire state of West Virginia. It's a great promotion person. And people buy into Dr. Gee, and that allows him to promote his message and promote the university. And he wears the bow tie funnel. So great, great image for me. So think back to your college psychology courses. You might remember primacy and recency effects. And if you don't, it's okay, fancy terms. All it really means is that people tend to remember their first impression and their most recent impression. And everything in the middle just kind of starts to fade away a little bit. Now, the most recent impression is a little bit easier for you to influence. If we're talking about consumers, you've got advertising. Hopefully they're coming into contact with your brand at multiple touch points. If it's in a B2B capacity, then you know maybe you've got a weekly conference call or email communication. You're always reinforcing that brand image. But that first image, that first impression, is really hard to control. And that's unfortunate because it's probably the most important one. So I have push play written here. And for me, that's both literal and figurative. In a literal sense, when I have new music that I need to go play for radio stations that I'm gonna ask them to play for me, I will physically go on the road and sit with them and present it in person, and I'll push play. And I do that for two reasons. Number one, I selfishly like to turn people on to new music, but the real reason I do it, number two, is that I wanna have a sense of the environment that they're in when they're experiencing my product for the first time. I've actually not played music for people because I knew they were having a bad day, bad mood, it just wasn't going to be received in the right way. So I backed off and decided, you know what, I'm going to do it at a later time. Quick story, 1999, I was working for Columbia Records in Cleveland. And we had this event called the Road Show, where we had a big artist showcase, and we flew in radio programmers and retailers from around the region. And all the executives from New York were coming in, our chairman, a bunch of executive vice presidents. It's a big deal. So the day before the event, I got a call that our chairman and our executive vice presidents wanted to go visit radio stations in Cleveland with me and watch what I do every day. So no pressure. So I viewed it as a great opportunity, and it was. We had a great day, great meetings with radio until we got to the rock station. And I press play, and I look over, and my program director, who makes all the decisions, is typing away on his computer, not really paying attention. So, you know, my chairman looks like he's about to have a heart attack. The mood in the room's kind of tense. I know I've got to do something to change the environment because my music isn't being portrayed in the right way. So I very politely kind of, you know, walked over to his desk and I was like, hey, you know, I just need 3 minutes and 48 seconds. You mind just kind of holding off for a minute? And, you know, I know you're trying to catch up, but really value your feedback. So do me a favor and just like stop working for a minute. So he's like, okay, he backs off. Mood in the room completely changes. I press play again. I no longer need to call 911 for my chairman. Everybody's happy. He likes the music. We end up leaving with an AirPlay commitment. Point of the story is this. If he was that distracted with the entire record label standing in his office, what's gonna happen when we're not there? It's gonna be on the phone, gonna be checking email, gonna be watching the TV. Not the way that I want someone to experience my product for the first time. So you can't always be there to do that. You can't always be there to control that environment. But you can create some anticipation for it. You know, if you can't be there to deliver your proposal, maybe you have them like book a conference room for an hour and send donuts, go old school. You know, do like a countdown clock so that they know that, you know, your product is coming. You can create some kind of anticipation, but what you don't want is indifference. You know, if I called that radio programmer and asked him what he thought about that record, and he says, I don't know, spend some more time with it, to me, that's the kiss of death. I want to hear, I hate it, so that I know where I have to start. I know I have to turn a no to a yes. Or I want to hear, I love it, so I know I've got a leader or maybe a first follower that's going to help me break a record. But what I don't want is for it to fall into the void. Here's a simple example, something Hillary Duff did about a week ago. She was releasing the name of her album, Breathe In, Breathe Out, in the artwork for the album. So she put it on balloons. Now, it's kind of a cheesy idea to put it on balloons. It goes along with Breathe In, Breathe Out. But what was cool about it was that she sent them to fans. And that's the way that they first learned what the title of the album was. It wasn't in the press, just the balloon showed up for the fans. The cool thing about it is that it was shared on social media. Mainstream media picked it up, and it got out there everywhere in the press. She controlled the first impression. Now when people think about, you know, when they first came in contact with that, when they first learned about, you know, the title and the artwork, her fans remember that. It made an impression. It's a balloon. Simple. By itself, not a great idea. The big idea was sending it to fans and getting it out that way. Much more effective than a press release just going out into the ether. And this is what we're trying to accomplish. This is Geoffrey Moore's concept of crossing the chasm, and it's very similar to the diffusion of innovation theory about how new technology diffuses through society. And the main idea is this. You've got your early market, you've got your leaders, your enthusiasts, and your visionaries, and they're the ones that just kind of get your product. They're there for you, they're leaders, you can count on them, they're always there. Then you've got the pragmatist, or the early majority, and they, the problem with them is that their reference point are other pragmatists. So you end up with this chasm between the people who get it and the people who sit back and want to wait and see what happens. So it creates that divide between the early market and the mainstream market. So how do we get there? The importance is to find the first followers, those first pragmatists, or the first people in that early majority that are going to stand up and wave their hand for you. You embrace them because they're the ones who influence the rest of that group. So I'm going to show you a quick video that I think perfectly illustrates what I'm talking about. It's a shaky handheld video, so I apologize if it makes you nauseous, but I think it's worth it.
If you've learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out and brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut, and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate the followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
Pretty great, right? Yeah. Yeah, pretty amazing. So you go back to this concept of the chasm. I mean, I could probably plug radio station call letters into each one of these boxes and diagram for you exactly how every record is broken. Problem is, it's different every time. Every product is different, has to be treated differently. But the one thing that remains consistent is the importance of finding those first followers. So before we get into some examples, I just want to issue a few promotion challenges to you. And the first one is the ease of repetition versus the challenge of imagination. What do I mean by that? The ease of repetition is, you know, just falling into the trap of doing the same things over and over again. And nothing will make your promotional efforts more stale than by just repeating them and doing the same things over and over. Whereas the challenge of imagination is looking at those promotional opportunities and thinking, how can you make them bigger? How can you add power to those you know, opportunities? The second is to look for the first mover advantage. Can you come up with an idea that is so far out of the box that nobody's thought of it before and no one's tried it? And you can't be afraid to fail. Find the first followers. We just saw the importance of that. And then the last thing is become a trusted partner and marketing resource. In my position, I can easily be seen as somebody who's always got his hand out, because I'm always asking for things. I'm asking for airplay. But my goal is to establish that reciprocity with my radio stations, my clients, so that they view me as a partner and not somebody with their hand out. One of the biggest compliments I ever got in this job was a radio station called me and asked for help promoting an artist. Had an artist coming to town, was running out of ideas, needed my help. But it was a competitive artist. And he called me and said, look, I know it's not your artist, but I'm kind of hitting a brick wall. You've got some good ideas. Can you help me out? So a little bit of an ethical dilemma, right? Do I help him promote a competitive artist? But I absolutely did it. And I did it for two reasons. One, because I thought it was good for my personal brand. But more importantly, it changed the dynamics of that relationship. I was viewed now as a resource, as a marketing partner to that radio station. So the next time I call, it's a whole different conversation. I'm not the guy who's calling just asking for something. I'm viewed as somebody who's also a resource. So if you can develop that sort of reciprocal relationship, it's hugely important. So I also provide content to radio stations in the form of access to our artists. So whether it's, you know, interviews or meet and greets or station visits or, you know, whatever it might be. Any of those promotions you hear on the radio that have anything to do with an artist, that's coming through us. So I try to be creative and I try to come up with things that are beneficial, not just for the radio station, but also that will help promote our artists and help create demand. So of all the promotions that I've done, the one thing that I've found is that experiences are the best kind of content. Sell the experience. For example, what would sound better on the radio? Be caller 9 to win a pair of Foo Fighters tickets? Okay. I mean, I might text in to win that. I might consider doing that. But if I don't win, I can still go buy tickets. If it's sold out, I could just pay a premium and still get tickets. So there aren't too many barriers to entry there. It's not that exciting. What if you heard, tell us what your favorite Foo Fighters song means to you, and you can win a chance to have dinner with the band backstage before the show? Now you got my attention. That's an experience. That's something I can't buy. And by the way, it costs us the same thing. It's that ease of repetition versus the challenge of imagination. How can you take an opportunity and turn it into something bigger? So here's an example of something I did with Kelly Clarkson a few months ago. Kelly released a new song called Heartbeat Song, and she lives in Nashville, and I had an opportunity to take her to the top 40 station in Nashville to record an interview with the morning show. Okay, I mean, recorded interviews happen all the time. It's a good opportunity, but nothing really that special. So how could I add power to that promotion? How could I make it into something that was more beneficial? So what I ended up doing was telling the station not to pre-promote the fact that Kelly was going to be on the radio. Instead, let's do a contest to find the biggest Kelly Clarkson fan in Nashville. So through online and social media and on air, they ran a contest and they narrowed it down to the three so-called biggest Kelly Clarkson fans in Nashville. And on the day that Kelly was scheduled to come in and record her interview, they were all invited into the radio station, along with a guest, to have a big contest on air. They were gonna be hooked up to heartbeat monitors to go along with our theme. And the idea was whoever got the most excited when they heard Kelly's new song was gonna be crowned the biggest Kelly Clarkson fan in Nashville. What they didn't know was that Kelly was gonna be there to surprise them. Here's how it looked.
All right, joining us here in the studio for our grand experiment we call Project Let's Be Best Friends with Kelly Clarkson, we have Colton, we have Madeline, and we have Sarah. Good morning!
Good morning!
All right, now, just a real quick thing. Why don't you tell everybody how old you are, where you're from, and stuff like that, starting with Sarah.
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
I was up on hanging out at the river, and I have to whisper because apparently Justin's been so loud, people recognize my voice. But there's fans in the other room, we're about to surprise them, and we put heart monitors on him. And we told him it was for something else, but I'm gonna walk in the room, hopefully we'll get some spikes, because we don't want to help you. We're gonna go in and I think they're gonna have like a dance contest or something, which obviously I should be involved in, since I'm Beyonce.
All three of you have been hooked up to heart monitors. You have little electrodes swimming all over your body. And we're going to test. Because you all claim to be the biggest Kelly Clarkson fans ever. So we're going to test your heart rate to see who is the biggest fan.
Okay, so here we go.
This is my heartbeat song, and I'm so long, I forgot how to turn it up, but my
So it turned out to be a lot of fun. She stayed on the air for over an hour, played games with the winners, and made for great radio. But that video you just saw ended up getting picked up by almost 200 iHeartMedia radio station websites and placed on their homepage the week of our single release. So it got great earned media pickup. We created an on-air and an online promotion. We activated her local fan base. Everybody started buzzing about the fact that there was a new Kelly Clarkson song. We created a Money Can't Buy experience. And the best part is, it didn't cost anything. And remember, it's just supposed to be a recorded interview. It's the ease of repetition versus the challenge of imagination. So a friend of mine, Jason Miller, used to work with me at Sony Music. And he's now the senior manager of content and social over at LinkedIn Marketing Solutions. And he recently published a book called Welcome to the Funnel. And he makes a great analogy about content. And it's a Thanksgiving turkey. And his idea is this. You've got this big piece of turkey, right? And you can't use it all at once. So for the next week or so, you know, you're making a turkey casserole, turkey sandwiches, you're using it in different ways. Content is kind of the same thing. If you have a big piece of content, you don't have to force it all into one channel. You can optimize it for different channels and use it in different ways. So in his example, he's got, you know, videos and webinars and infographics. If you think about the Kelly Clarkson example, we had on air, we had online, we had an experience, we had the video that we can use. So when you're thinking about your content, think about how it can be, you know, used in different ways to elongate and add more power to your promotional efforts. And that's another great visual for me since I'm a visual person, so I think that makes a lot of sense. So I talked earlier about finding the first mover advantage and thinking outside the box. Weird Al released a new album called Mandatory Fun. And, you know, Weird Al was really a product of MTV. Well, Weird Al hadn't made an album in a really long time, And MTV is not really what it used to be. So the old model was kind of broken for him. So what do? He thought about making a video and just putting it out on YouTube and hoping it went viral. Well, as Luke Sullivan said, viral is an outcome, not a strategy. You can't plan on something going viral. So what do? So he came up with a great idea to release 8 videos in 8 days leading up to the release of the album. Really smart plan, the only problem is videos are really expensive. And to do 8 of them at once, it's just not cost effective. You can't do it. But he loved the idea, so he found some brand partners. He partnered with Yahoo, Nerdist, Funny or Die, and College Humor. They paid for the videos in exchange for being able to house the content. So the promotion could go forward, and it wasn't going to cost anybody anything except for those partners. So the first day happens, releases a video, gets great pickup, and the hashtag starts to get out there. Day 2, people are starting to figure out, like, hey, this thing's really happening. There's going to be a new video every day. So it starts to turn into appointment viewing. People are going back to find out what's going on. It starts to create some buzz. By day 4, mainstream media is all over this. He's doing interviews in the newspaper, on radio. He's on CNBC. And when you think about it, CNBC probably reaches his target audience better than MTV could have. So it's a great campaign, leads up to the release of the album. So what was the result? He sold 104,000 albums in the first week, which was good enough for the number one album in the country. His first number one ever. Now you think about the heyday of all those hits and, you know, it's funny to think about, but his first number one ever. And it wasn't on the strength of a hit single or a funny or creative video. It was on the strength of the campaign. It was the idea. It was brilliant. So I want to touch on social media quickly. I mentioned earlier how, you know, it could be used to create that reciprocal relationship and not just for sales pitches. Taylor Swift is probably the queen of social media engagement. She's one of those people that communicates from the inside out. You know, her purpose, her motivation, are her fans. And she makes, you know, she makes that known to her fan base, and they love her for it. So something she did over the holidays, she used social media to learn about her fans. She went to their profiles, she found out their likes, their interests, where they live, what they do, she watched their videos, who they hang out with. And based on that, she went out Christmas shopping for them. She personally went out shopping, then she wrapped all the presents, and then she sent them to her fans with a note. In some cases, she hand-delivered them. There was no sales pitch, there was no buy my album, it was just kind of her way of saying thank you.
A number of Taylor Swift fans celebrated a very merry so-called Swiftmas over the holidays, receiving gifts from their idol in the mail. Now, as it turns out, Taylor selected and hand-wrapped all the gifts herself, which I think is so sweet. She recently posted the video showing us behind the scenes at her own Christmas workshop where she was assisted by her own little furry elves. Those are her cats, and yours could do this as well. This video of the star and the reaction of her fans is going crazy viral right now with over 4 million views on YouTube. And Inga said that to you before, I'm so touched by her sincerity and kind of wisdom beyond her years. You've met her.
She is an old soul and she's so kind and she truly gets why she is who she is because her fans believe in her and support her and so she gives back. It's amazing.
She does so much from those private concerts to go, like, she is seriously an example for celebrities everywhere of what you can, the little things you can do.
And the impact they have.
Yeah, it really does. They never forget that.
And she's very helpful when you're on the elliptical with her,
you know that the only person you listen to on the elliptical is Katy Perry. Don't try to say Taylor Swift. You know,
I'm working around the rotation.
I'm an omnivore when it comes to divas. I listen to all of them.
So great earned media because of that. And that video now, by the way, had I think it's like 12 million views now. It was 4 million when they talked about it. So what I thought was so impressive about that was it's how she used social media. She used social to make that happen. So great social content equals great social value. So I plugged Taylor into this social lift calculator that we have on a dashboard that I use just to kind of see. This is a 30-day value for social efforts, and it doesn't even include some of the other channels. This is really about, you know, YouTube views and Twitter and Facebook. And these assumptions, they're adjustable, but it basically assumes that it would take 3 cents of advertising to get someone to watch a YouTube video and up to $8 of advertising to get someone to retweet on your behalf. but $31 million over 30 days. And I don't know if you can see at the bottom, but that's actually down almost $6 million from the previous 30 days. That's an unbelievable amount of value, and that's just based on great social content. No sales pitches, just her making a connection with her audience. Now, that's the kind of thing we can't do. People don't buy record labels. They buy the artists. We're more of a B2B company. We're dealing with radio stations and television stations. It's the artists that are dealing directly with the public. So it's amazing when something like this can happen. So I wrote a blog post called Aggregation versus Fragmentation when I talked about the benefits of aggregating your social content onto a website. And I argued that for two reasons. Number one, it drives traffic to your website. But number two, there's a cross-pollination thing that happens there. You know, if I follow you on Twitter, but on your website I see the content that you're posting on Facebook or Instagram, then I might decide to follow you in those channels as well. This is something Interscope Records does, and I think they do a really good job. The one thing that they could do better, and something that we don't do at all, and I think we should do as well, is to include, you know, more user-generated content. You know, retweets, maybe some trending hashtags. Get the consumer voice involved in some of that. I mean, you think about it, these are your brand advocates. You know, and peer-to-peer recommendations are so much more valuable than any kind of advertising. So why wouldn't you want to create a channel for these fans to advocate on your behalf? So I was trying to think of a good example, and I thought about this. The Hot 100 is Billboard's chart that ranks the top 100 singles each week in the country. For 50 years, they used the same formula. It was airplay and sales, and based on that, they would, you know, determine the top 100 songs in the country. Well, in February 2013, they did something which at the time was a little crazy. They decided to add a third component to their algorithm, which was going to be streaming media, which meant that Spotify, Pandora would now affect the chart, but also YouTube. Now, what a lot of people didn't think about was that user-generated content was also going to affect that chart. So if I create a video and I use at least 30 seconds of someone's song, for every time that gets played, the stream credit goes to the copyright holder. So a lot of people, myself included, in the industry were kind of looking at this saying, okay, well, what's really going to happen when streaming media gets added? Maybe there's some movement between 15 and 10 on the chart. What's going to happen? So something interesting was happening that same week, which you'll probably remember. The Harlem Shake. There were hundreds of those videos, and most of them went viral, millions and millions of views. So the Billboard chart comes out February 20th, 2013, and there was some movement on the chart, all right. Harlem Shake debuted at number one on the Hot 100 chart. Everyone's scratching their heads. How can that be? Gatekeepers are furious. I'm not playing the record. How's that a number one record? The consumer voice spoke. User-generated content made that happen, right? Fans created a number one record. Without that, that record never even charts. Just an example of how including the consumer voice in your promotional efforts can make a huge difference. This by far is my favorite campaign. In 2013, Pharrell wrote the song Happy. What a lot of people don't know is that it was written for the Despicable Me 2 soundtrack, right? It was in the movie, it was on the soundtrack, sold about 50,000 copies, and you know, that was kind of it. The movie ran its course, and that was all. So for a lot of artists, they'd say, okay, great exposure, that was awesome. Pharrell, you know, was thinking bigger. Again, that ease of repetition, challenge of imagination. How can you make it bigger? What can you do to create an experience? How can you communicate from the inside out to try to make the world a happier place? How do you include user-generated content? How do you put all those things we've been talking about into one campaign? So he enlisted the help of an agency named Iconoclast to help him come up with a campaign, and the result was pretty phenomenal.
In November 2013, Pharrell Williams wrote, produced, and performed the track Happy for the movie Despicable Me 2. He came to us a few months later with a question. How can we launch this track in a new way? How can we turn a song into a great experience? And could we make even this track a first step towards a happier world? So we came back with a crazy idea, and Pharrell loved it. A 24-hour interactive experience. More than 300 people dancing in a truly happy way. A 24-hour performance of Pharrell recorded in one single shot. Without any media, we had more than 9 million people enjoying the experience for an average time of 6 minutes. The music video, which regrouped the best moments of the experience, was seen over 200 million times. Sales of the track exploded, jumping from 50,000 copies before the experience to 7 million just a few weeks later.
Boom!
It went viral.
When people started putting videos around the world of themselves getting happy.
And the whole world wanted to share this amazing feeling of happiness. Meanwhile, we created the platform wearehappyfrom.com for people to share their own happy video. We had roughly 1,500 homemade versions of the music video, done in over 130 countries, adding more than 100 hours of happiness to our experience.
Makes me cry too, makes me cry too!
And the story could have stopped there. With this global enthusiasm, the UN came to us with the idea of creating the platform 24hoursofhappiness.com to raise money for the humanitarian effort, which proved to be a great success. The UN decided that March 20th is from now on the Global Day of Happiness, and Pharrell Williams is the official sponsor.
I'm happy, man.
He's happy. He's also wearing a bow tie, by the way. So, let's say you've got these promotional efforts in markets, and you know your promotional efforts can't exist in a vacuum. So how do you tie something together with your overall marketing plan, your overall campaign? You know, if you're going market to market, and it can be done through storytelling. You know, marketing's not about the stuff that you make, but about the stories that you tell. Or another way to say that is, it's not about the what, it's about the why. So storytelling can be used to connect the dots between all of your efforts. A good story is authentic. It's got to be real. People have to believe it. It's got to be creative. It's got to make that emotional connection. It's got to inspire action, and it can take an audience on a journey with your brand. It can immerse somebody in your brand. It can help to tell your story. So I was trying to think of a good example of that, and I thought about a campaign that we did at RCA Records with Justin Timberlake. And as the story goes, there was a couple on a train in New York. And the guy proposed to his girlfriend while playing the song Not a Bad Thing on one of those wireless Beats pills. So people witnessed it. They were moved by it. Justin heard about it. There were some documentary filmmakers that thought it'd be a great idea to try to find this couple. RCA got involved. So between the three parties, we decided that this would make a great music video. So it became a campaign in New York City to find this couple, which then became the music video. And I wanted to share it with you.
This is a true story. January 12, 2014. It was a crisp, cold, sunny night on a Long Island railroad train speeding towards New York City. It was a scene out of a movie, like Say Anything. A young man proposed to his girlfriend playing a Justin Timberlake song. They were so in love. You almost never see that. We don't know who these people are or what their story is. But maybe you do. We're making a documentary about finding love. Have you seen this couple?
It's not something you really look for. It's not scripted. It just happens.
You find love and then you lose love. And then you have to work to find it again. And then you lose it.
I think if you really, like, you know, grow yourself and get to really know yourself first, then you can find love.
We heard this crazy story from a friend about a couple that proposed on the Long Island Railroad. And now we're trying to find them.
Studio, documentarians who are trying to find this couple. The theme song to this couple's future is Justin Timberlake's epic love song, Not a Bad Thing. We are looking for you to help us find this guy and this girl.
I think when you publicly propose to somebody, it really inspires love all around.
Proposals you plan in your head, you plan it on paper, and in the end, it's just who you're asking to marry and spend the rest of your life with.
I rolled out of bed one morning before my wife and said, will you marry me?
I was confident that she would say yes, otherwise,
No, you weren't confident.
I was confident.
How about I be the last one to be alone? Every other night, for the rest of your life, I set them off. Every morning, I just want to see you.
That's it.
I think love is an attachment, and I found that I was so attached to my lady that I couldn't love anyone else.
This has got to be done.
I think it's like a very brave thing to look for love, to fall in love, and to ask someone to love you back.
Good, let's go.
My heart's racing,
I think. I'm just gonna walk up and be like, yeah, we've been looking for you.
Love is not this gold in a straight line. They're like curves and twists and turns and bumps.
Love finds you.
Yeah, it finds you.
Never did find them. Some question if they ever existed, but just saying. But what a great way to, you know, tell the story of a song that's about looking for and finding love, to have, you know, couples that represent that and tell that story. So while that was a campaign that actually existed in New York City, the video of it we used throughout the country and even helped our global efforts to promote the single. So just to kind of sum things up, yeah, we talked about some of the fundamentals of communicating and of you know, good promotion. That visual of the bow tie funnel with, you know, awareness on one end and conversion in the middle, and your advocacy efforts on the other side. Promotion, the fabric that ties it all together. Push play, trying to control that environment, or at least influence the environment that your consumers are in or that your client is in when they first experience your product, your brand, your idea. The importance of finding the first followers. Talked about great content, how you can sell the experience, and how that content can be optimized through different channels to help your efforts. First mover advantage, the Weird Al example. Think of something that's outside the box that nobody's done before. creating personal connections, and I use that Taylor Swift social media example, how it can be used not just to push data, but to actually, you know, make that reciprocal connection. How the consumer voice can exponentially increase the reach of your efforts if you can tap into it. Great campaign. You know, it made the Harlem Shake a number one record and made Pharrell the number one song of 2014. And then finally, we just talked about using storytelling to connect the dots and also to help communicate brand meeting. And with that, I will say thank you. This is up on SlideShare if you're interested. I appreciate it. Thank you.
One more time.
Yeah. The Timberlake video is great, isn't it? Yeah. Any questions at all?
So whose heart was racing the most of the sample that you showed us? Who's the biggest fan?
The guy was. Yeah. And I think it was pretty easy to tell. And we were worried about that because, you know, we had to sneak her in, and we had her in a room that was just on the other side of the on-air studio, and there were these, you know, these blinds, and she kept peeking through, and I was afraid they were going to see her, but they never did. So it worked out well. So anything else? I know we're just about out of time. Yeah.
I can't remember when it happened, but I remember one night I was on Twitter, and it was like all these tweets about Beyonce, like she like shut down the internet.
Yeah.
She only exclusively released the album on iTunes,
yeah.
All included like videos. What do you think about that? Like, do you see that
change? There's a couple things. I mean, you know, obviously those are really designed, and there was something that happened to us this past week with ASAP Rocky where the album release date was supposed to be Tuesday and he just dropped it unannounced on Friday. That was a planned thing to avoid leaks. Beyonce, the same thing. It's just a way to generate more demand. It gets that earned media happening. You can tell everybody that it's coming, but if you drop it, now you've got an event. It's something everybody's going to talk about. So you put it on Twitter, people share it. It's just, you know, it's almost just a cheap way to create more excitement.
That's what I was going to say. Do you think that's better for the artists to receive more funds for their work? Because you know how like music can get leaked, and they're not
doing
it. But like she did that, so I'm sure she received the benefits from it.
Well, she's a good example because I don't think it matters to her. You know, she doesn't need the money, so it's more about, you know, continuing the growth of her personal brand. And she's great. I worked with her in Destiny's Child a long time ago, and she's amazing. But now she's at this level that it's crazy. But yeah, I mean, I think if you can release something like that, sure, if you can get away with it. But you got to be a superstar artist to get away with something like that. If you're a new and developing artist, there's not going to be that demand that's there. So it's not going to have the same effect. I wouldn't recommend it all the time. Again, that first mover advantage thing, you do it once, it'll work. Do it again, it doesn't mean anything anymore. Hi, Patty. Yes, it's up there right there, slideshare.net/AndyFlick. The videos aren't there, but if you guys want videos, ask me and I will find a way to Dropbox them to you. Thank you. Hey, Mike.
You might want to check with Colin. He posted a survey question. I'd be interested in the results.
Uh-oh. Okay. By the way, take 637. Right. What was it? Did you post something? No? Okay. We'll check with them later. Yeah. Yeah.
So how has SiriusXM affected you guys in the music industry? Because while it is pretty widespread, you know, obviously it's not accessible to everyone at this point.
And right.
SiriusXM kind of tries to say, you know, well, we're the first, we're the people who are finding music first. You know, what's your relationship like with that?
Part of that's kind of true. We love our charts in the music business. I showed the Hot 100 chart. I talked about the albums chart for Weird Al. We have airplay charts every week for different formats. The thing with SiriusXM is that there are several channels that do affect our charts. Hits 1 affects the Top 40 mainstream chart. So it's definitely an important outlet. The difference is it's a non-commercial station. So for a commercial Top 40 radio station, their highest rotation of a record might be, you know, 75 plays a week. If you're not playing commercials on XM, you can play, you know, 100 and sometimes a week. So that airplay matters. How much audience there is debatable. But I just view it as an additional channel, and I sort of just lump it into the overall radio mix because that's kind of the way we treat it. You know, we have somebody that promotes to them, ask them to play our music. They don't really get a lot of exclusives. They might position it that way, but they're getting music the same time as everybody else. Yeah.
What is something that you've seen successful for a non-established new artist?
There's a lot of them. you know, on a simple level, something I did with an artist named Hot Shell Ray, we did a lot of Twitter takeovers. So we'd partner with a radio station and take over their Twitter. So they would post a picture of themselves on the radio station handle. It'd be pre-promoted, and they, you know, do a chat for an hour. We did that in a few markets. Actually turned out really well. We saw a sales lift as a result. So just little things like that, because I mean, when you're a newer and developing artist or not known as well, it's hard to pull off some of these bigger things. But I like these examples because, you know, it was everything from, you know, one local effort that I did in Nashville with Kelly to a full-blown, you know, global effort that they did with Pharrell. So I just kind of wanted to show you the whole range. But yeah, for developing artists, you know, it's hard because it's hard to get radios buy into that. That's when we're really pushing, we're really promoting those baby bands. But when they get to that level, radio's coming to us because they want access.
Right.
So it's that tipping point thing again, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I talked earlier about, you know, what does a label do? Mm-hmm. And, you know, our resources are somewhat limited. We're not signing a lot of artists. We're partnering with artists. But most of them have generated their own level of demand to a point where they can't handle it themselves anymore. And they need a larger marketing partner. So I haven't seen too many artists get picked up by a label that just came out of obscurity. Usually there's some buzz already happening, whether it's on social media, YouTube as you suggested, or they've been touring with somebody and they've, you know, there's hundreds of people coming out every night to see them. So there's some kind of buzz that's there. YouTube definitely helps. It's, you know, an indicator for us, certainly. You can look at the number of views, and I know that's kind of a forward-facing number. You got to look at the uniques on that, but definitely, you know, we have an A&R team that is responsible for signing new content, new artists. They put them together, like songwriters and artists together, and they're really the ones that piece it all together. So, but they're out looking for artists all the time, and I know that they pay close attention to what's happening on YouTube and other platforms as well. Anybody else? Thank you. You good? What was the survey question?
So were you the lone nut or the first follower?
Ooh. I'd like to say I'm the first follower because that makes the most difference.